sweep away bureaucracy. What we want to do is to get rid of the ministry offices altogether. Because they are a bureaucratic nightmare. All they do is they force compliance on schools. We want to get gone. That's not the way you run an education system like that. We want them gone because they just represent major, major bureaucracies. And they represent centralization. We want to replace them with what we call education hubs. And what's an education hub look like? Well, an education hub will do two things. It will provide a local service, and I mean local. Schools will know about where their education is. Schools will interact with people in the education hub. The education hub will be staffed with people who are capable. And that education hub will provide schools with the business advice they need, the property, the HR, the security, all of that stuff, which more than trustees find really difficult, which always is fun. We want the hub to be able to support boards to do that, is the first thing. And the second thing we want is we want the hubs to provide true professional development advisory services for teachers and leadership services for teachers. If I was going to say what's the important thing for hubs, it's that. Is to provide support, the missing support that teachers and leaders have not had. By the way, you know, this five-year contract for principals has been a whole lot of stuff going on here. We don't see principals being moved from one school to another without mutual agreement. But we do see the possibilities of, if principals want to, sharing leadership of crowds across a number of schools. So when you read about people saying that somehow principals are being ripped off, taken away, moved their children, that's just not right. That's not what we're saying. What we are saying is opportunity for principals to move around. Cathy's going to talk more about cuts. I want to finish off with just a few things about what this is not about. Okay? First of all, this is not radical. If you go over overseas jurisdictions, you know, most successful education countries actually have something like that idea. This is not radical. Second thing, it's not about creating faceless bureaucracy that tells you what to do. It is not about that. Actually, it's about decentralizing. The ministry regional offices are removed, and we give education hubs, we call them crown agencies, and we let them make local decisions closer to the school, rather than allowing ministry regional offices to drive compliance behavior. So this is not about bureaucracy. This is not about centralized assets. It's about decentralization. It's not about, as somebody said, vanilla schools. Every school will be the same. Well, what we're saying is absolutely not. Boards of trustees and principals will be able to do what they want in terms of the nature and the character of their school. What we're talking about is providing support, professional development, advice for schools, which has been missing for a long, long time. Finally, I want to just address one last thing, which is the sort of iron life jacket syndrome. You know what? That's a bit of a thing that's going on at the moment. People are saying, our board is alright, our school is alright, leave us alone and go and help those ones that aren't working. Aren't we? You know, for me, that, you know, leave us alone. What do we have to do? How did that happen in this country? How did that happen? We look after ourselves, and those people we exclude. I can't believe that. How do you do that anyway? How do you create a dual system? How do you decide who's going to be left alone and who's not? How do you ensure that over time things don't change? You know, I don't think school performance is a binary, you can and you can't. School performance is a continuum. You know, schools do good things here and lots of good things here, so it's a continuum, and I just don't think it's right for us to be thinking about a dual system. But that idea of a dual system is actually completely flawed. I think all schools would benefit from an education hub that's working properly. All schools contribute to an education hub that's working properly. All schools could work together for the good of all their children. And that's really what our proposals are about. Thank you very much.
center. And I think it's fair to say we'll be bringing a slightly different perspective on the proposals. His name is Professor Gary Hawke. Now, if I went through Professor Hawke's entire CV, we wouldn't have time for him to speak himself or any of the other speakers for that matter. So what I will say is that Professor Hawke is an emeritus professor at the University of Victoria in economics. He taught there for a long time in educational policy. He works for the New Zealand Institute of Economic Research as an economist. And perhaps most importantly for us tonight, Professor Hawke was involved in the PICO report. So tonight we're hearing about the Haque report. The PICO report was the document that brought about tomorrow's schools in the first place. So Gary has been part of this discussion for exactly 30 years. So we're very pleased that he's been able to come up to Melbourne and join us and give us the experience of his perspective tonight. Welcome, Gary.
Something similar to the PICO Committee in relation to tertiary education. And since then I've been involved with HERO, the Advisory Committee on Quality of Education. I've been involved with NZQA in the assessment area, and I've been a consultant of the Ministry on a number of occasions. At the moment I chair the PLT Accreditation Committee, and the process of managing PLP in our schools doesn't seem to really have much to do with what Bali was describing earlier tonight. It's very much run by teachers, for teachers. If there's any criticism we made of the PLP scheme, it's that there's not enough central direction over what it is that the PLP should be particularly aimed at. My criticism of the Our School in the Future, the report that Bali has introduced, is really about its failure as a contribution to public policy and public management. Bali has emphasised the amount of research the Vision Committee did. I must say in the report it's not obvious. The report proceeds very much directly from commentary. It's not perfect to therefore it should be done. There's no inquiry as to what seems very obvious hasn't already been done. And there's no analysis to establish that a feasible alternative would be an improvement. The report treats teacher complaints as justified and as a basis for recommending changes by others. Claims of the result of writing, but the material cited in the report is overwhelming to teachers. We heard, we were told, introduce that as a fact and become the basis for recommendation. Testimony is non-evidence, not at least not evidence of what's alleged, although it's evidence of what's believed, and it's a reason to inquire whether the belief is justified. The report's curiously ahistorical. It works with a world of before and after tomorrow's schools. But much has happened in the 30 years since tomorrow's schools. The way the curriculum is developed, the introduction of NCDA, changes made in the processes of HERO, and much more have all happened since tomorrow's school. And the shape of those changes has not been determined by the way the school governance was constructed and managed. As long ago as 2009, John Haque described the metaphor of tomorrow's schools as yesterday's news. Much also happened before tomorrow's school. There was an education development.